Hello flight simmers, welcome back, and do we have a fun aircraft for you. So the other day I made a bit of an impulse purchase and picked up the Rara-Avis Sims Bulldog Autogyro. Now it may look like something out of Wacky Races, and despite its classic appearance, the body is actually made of carbon fibre, and it was introduced at the Aerod Friedrichshafen, I hope I said that right, air show in 2015. The textures look outstanding, everything is crisp and sharp, even up close. Now, full disclosure, I knew nothing about autogyros before I bought this. It just looked kind of quirky and that appealed to me. But here's what I've learned so far. Both the rotor and prop have fixed blades. This means there's no collective or propeller knob, just fuel mixture and throttle. And the main rotor is completely unpowered. The rotation is produced purely by air passing over the blades. On the ground, the airflow from the front prop gets the rotor started, and the rotors move faster as you pick up speed. This is where we get the auto part of autogyro, because the aircraft flies by autorotation. This does give us some slightly unusual flight dynamics which take a little bit of getting used to, but we'll come to that later. There's no elevator or ailerons to guide the aircraft, just the rudder at the back. All other flight control comes from the pitch and bank angle of the main rotor. The vintage look continues in the cockpit. We have our fuel and throttle controls, gauges, our ignition, but you may be wondering where the electrics are. In true James Bond style, they're hidden away in this armrest. We have battery, fuel valve, magnetos, alternator, avionics, as well as these switches to toggle the spats, decals, and GPS unit. What GPS unit, I hear you say? Well, this thing is pretty well set up for VR, so if I aim my head in just the right place and use the VR zoom, there it is, with a co-pilot along with a sign which I think I might get made to go in my car. And if you look in the right armrest, you'll find the radio and transponder. We're flying today from Leon Solent in the UK. So without further ado, let's get this thing started. We'll start by setting our mixture to full rich. Then turn on the battery, fuel valve, magnetos, and avionics. Now this thing doesn't have a parking brake, or at least not one that I've found, so I'd recommend pressing the tow brakes before turning the ignition. Or you may find yourself shooting forward into the hangar in front of you. The engine does sound fantastic, but it is pretty loud. We can now turn the alternator on. It does sometimes take a couple of attempts to get through to the GPS. There we go. Not actually going to be using the GPS on this flight, but I wanted to show that it does work. Okay, let's release our brakes and start our taxi. Now it's a tail dragger, so you can do some pretty sharp turns. In classic tail dragger fashion, the visibility ahead when taxiing is severely limited. If you're using VR, you may find it easiest just to lean out on one side or the other. If you're not in VR, then you may just want to switch to the external camera for taxiing. And you really need to keep your taxi speed low. It doesn't take a lot of airspeed to make the tail lift, and if the tail lifts, you lose all steering control. But it does look so damn cool. Okay, let's line up for takeoff. And throttle up. As you can see, it barely needs any runway at all. It can't quite do a vertical takeoff, but that's not far off. In fact, with a strong headwind, you practically can do a vertical takeoff. All it takes is some throttle and just gently pitching back, and the whole thing just lifts up in the air. It almost feels more like you're floating rather than flying. The beauty of an autogyro of a fixed-wing plane is that it can go as slow as you like without stalling, which means you can actually climb quite aggressively without any risk. In fact, autogyros are generally considered safer than fixed-wing or conventional rotorcraft for this reason. If you have an engine failure, it's really easy to safely glide to the ground, and you don't need to worry about your airspeed getting too low like you would in a fixed-wing aircraft, or losing the RPM to keep your tail under control like you would in a helicopter. Top speed is around 90 knots, which puts on par with a lot of light GA planes and helicopters. So, now we know we're safe as houses and nothing could possibly go wrong, let's try some aerobatics. The loop was nice and easy, I just pulled back on the stick and round it went. However, lateral movements are a bit slower to respond, so let's try a roll and see what happens. We made it round, but we lost a lot of altitude. As well as short takeoffs, this thing can do some pretty good short landings too. To demonstrate, I'm going to attempt to land on this carrier. Now, bear in mind, I've only flown this thing a handful of times, so I imagine someone actually knew what they're doing could do a much better job of it. In fact, the one I did before this was perfect, but somebody forgot to hit record. Due to the way this thing flies, reducing the throttle will reduce the speed, but only has a marginal effect on the descent rate. Obviously, you want to slow down for the landing, but to descend, you need to push the aircraft down using the stick. However, the biggest challenge here is the Cobalt's head blocking my view of the runway, and even leaning out the side doesn't help that much. The easiest technique is to approach on a slight dogleg, and then correct just before you cross the threshold. Try to resist the urge to flare just before you touch down. You want to level off, but if you pull up, you'll just go back up again. This takes some getting used to, but it does mean if you need to do a go around, it's really easy to get back up in the air. And here we are, safe on the deck of the HMS Queen Elizabeth, where it blends in perfectly alongside the F-35. The HMS Queen Elizabeth has a launch ramp at the end of the runway, but we won't need it, because, like our cousin, the F-35, we can just pitch back, hit the gas, and launch straight into the air. I don't know how much one of these costs, but I'm fairly confident it costs less than an F-35. Now, I mentioned earlier that autogyros are considered very safe due to the fact that they can't stall and are easy to auto-rotate to the ground. To demonstrate this, I'm going to close the fuel valve and try to glide it onto the runway. This is actually going to be the first time I've tried doing this, so let's see how it goes. The fuel is off and the engine has died. But when I looked down to find the switch, I inadvertently pitched up and lost a lot of airspeed. I now have to dive more steep than I would like, in order to regain some airspeed and keep the rotors going. While I shouldn't just drop out of the sky, I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to reach the runway. The no stalling thing only works as long as there's still air passing over the rotors. When the engine is running, you can go really slow because the engine provides the airflow. Without the engine though, you still need airspeed. I'm getting pretty close to the ground now, and have no spare altitude left to trade for speed. I just have to hope I have enough energy to make it to the runway. Well, we came up a little short, but we made it. You'll need to gently apply the brakes and pitch back to get the tailwheel down, or you won't be able to steer. So then, final thoughts. I've never flown anything like this aircraft before. I love the look of it. You know, if you turn up at an air show in this thing, everyone's going to stop what they're doing and do a double take. I think they've done a great job with the textures, and it works really well in VR. It's very easy to fly without being boring too. It can get a little bumpy with a tailwind, and I do find myself thinking I should be dropping out the sky, but so far I've had no issues. I honestly can't speak to the accuracy of the flight model as I have no basis for comparison, but if you've flown a real autogyro and had a go with this, then do let me know your thoughts in the comments. Short takeoff and landing capabilities make it ideal for bush trips, and I find myself wondering if it'd be possible to fit it with floats as well. To be honest, when I first downloaded it, I just thought it was going to be a novelty, but this is actually a really great aircraft, and I anticipate clocking up a few good hours in the future. If you've enjoyed this video, please hit the subscribe button. Until next time, fly safe.